S. Buck. She was an American novelist. Let's put the quote up there. She lived in China in the 1930s with her parents, who were missionaries doing work among the Chinese people. We have some Chinese people in our church. And she was one of the forerunners, disruptors of adoption agencies in the 1930s, who started orphanages in Korea and China. And one of the reasons why Chinese adoption became so propelled was by her writing. She was also a Pulitzer winner in the United States, and also she was the first woman to win the Nobel Prize in literature. She paved the way. So maybe we want to listen to her in what she has to say about fatalism. Read it with me. Fatalism is what? What will be is not what? Necessarily what must be. What fatalism is a false premise. What will be is not necessarily what must be. She was told, Pearl was told in China, that women belong in the kitchen. That you need to tape your foot if you want to get married, because it has to be small, really small. She was told and taught about this form of sexism, that women should never write, they'll never win this award. But what? She proved everybody wrong. She was a nasty woman. How many nasty women do we have in our church? In a good way. But she disrupted industry, not only in literature as a woman, who really depicted in literature what the Nobel Prize was, she depicted in a novel so beautifully and so painfully the poverty in China. And how people lived. And it stirred up people's hearts for adoption. And it changed the world. So first thing you learn is that if you want to change the world, anyone who has ever disrupted industry, changed the world in any fashion, had to overcome their sense of fatalism. But you know what? She says that what will be is not necessarily what must be. But I tell you, sometimes, when I get on that scale, I've been on this diet for a decade now. It's hard not to be fatalistic. I go on the scale, why even bother? Why even bother running? Why even bother counting calories? Weight Watchers? If I need to watch my weight, I can get a scale. Why do I need a system telling me this and that? And so, I know from personal experience that fatalism is not empirical or actually facts, but it's really, really seems like it's personal and it seems true, right? A friend betrays you more than once, or three friends betray you, or a family member betrays you. And it feels like now I can't what? Trust anybody. I did my doctoral study on analysis of multiples amount of people that I had to survey. If you want to do a study, a doctoral study that's actually legitimate, you can't have 3, 4, 5, even 7 samples. You need hundreds, maybe thousands of samples. But 3 people betrayed me, so I'm never going to trust again. Because everybody is out to get me. How many people know people like that? No, they're out to get me. So you go to a restaurant. My son's like this. He thinks that everybody is out to get him. He goes, Dad, you need to make this right. This is against my civil rights. I'm like, no, they just messed up your burger, bro. Stop. I said copy the things that are not, copy the things that are good about me, not bad about me. Don't learn this behavior from me. And fatalism is not empirical, because the truth is 3 people is not enough sample. Even 10 people are not enough samples. It's personal to us, because the people we're the closest to have hurt us, and therefore we don't trust. And therefore we create a framework to live in that world. So we we don't get hurt again. But that's not empirical. That's not fact. It feels like fact. It could be existential. It's an existential crisis. It could be a visceral one, a personal one, but it's not fact. The fact is, the next person could be the love of your life. In fact, mine was. Like, I don't want any more friends. I don't want any more girlfriends. I don't believe people anymore. But the next person that I opened my heart to was my wife. Say, praise the Lord. People are like, thank you. They're like, thank God, Pastor, say you married Pastor Lydia or you would be ruined. Everybody knows she's the backbone of my life. And so when we have a fatalistic worldview about even faith and about our life, we get stuck to the greatest miracles, to the mysterious work the Lord has, whether you're a seeker or whether you're a believer. Because you believe that you know the future. It could be somatic, but it's not empirical. Meaning you have unresolved issues from that pain and you don't want to be hurt again. You know what is empirical? We consider science empirical. Here's what's empirical. Einstein proved it. The universe itself is not fixed. Right? Scientists are finding planets like Skittles right now in the Milky Way. There's like a green one, yellow one, a blue one. It's everywhere. We found seven planets that might have life. We found another planet that actually might be the ninth planet, NASA. I'm like, you guys really don't know anything, do you? The universe is not fixed. The universe, Einstein and EMC squared proved that the universe itself is perpetually expanding. It's moving in a direction, moving away from each other. So if the universe, matter itself, is not fixed, meaning it's not determined, we don't know where it's going, what's happening, but we know it's in movement. If matter itself is moving, nothing is fixed. Nothing is fatal. Everything is actually open. So fatalism, if you really look at it objectively, it's not even aligned with reality. So whatever you might be going through in your life today, that you feel like it's fixed and it's the end, that's not in line with reality, is it? It feels like it, though. And so today, that's what I want to talk about, how the gospel saves us from our fatalism, from our place of stuckness in life, so that he can disrupt and interrupt the places that we see through a fatalistic lens and set us free so he can use us and take us to places we could never even imagine. How many people would want that? You like being stuck? And so, we're going to go to this passage today in Matthew, where for the first time, a historical disruption takes place. Some guy walks on water. Now, I heard some missionary say that they walked on water, but I don't really believe that. I don't buy it, because I wasn't there. But they recorded this event. Peter, Apostle Peter, walked on water. We know this happened because Jay-Z talks about this too in a cameo in one of those songs back then when Kanye was still good in Diamonds, when he says, I have to get out of the boat so I could walk on water. I sold kilos of coke. I guess I can sell CDs. I'm a businessman. No, I'm a businessman. Let me handle my business. Okay, then you know what he says after. I mean, if Jay-Z referenced it, it must have happened. I mean, you think about this in this text. The gospel particularly likes to take people. Jesus particularly likes to address the issues in our lives that we think that we know better than the Creator. See, everything in this universe is not fixed. Change is the only constant that we'll ever know. Everything is evolving, in essence. The only thing that's not evolving, the only thing that's immutable is God himself. He's outside of time and space. He's outside of the universe. And therefore, God loves to show us that there's a much bigger world here in reality than we know. Then also that we've experienced in our own lives. So Jesus here decides to do a conversion experience for the disciples. So let's read from verse 25. It says that shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them, walking out on the lake. You see Jesus here? Anybody thinks that Jesus is serious? You know, A.B. Tozer said, what you think about God is the most important thing that you believe. Because how you see God will affect everything. And if you think that Jesus is this angry dude or holier thou dude, you need to read this 25 again. Surely before dawn, Jesus went out to them, walking out to the lake. Like Jesus thought this was normal. Can you imagine? It was night, the text says. And Jesus just walked out to them at dark. And the disciples were like, when the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. They said, it's a ghost, they said, and cried out in fear. He did Casper on them. Jesus did Casper on the disciples to show them that nothing is fixed. He did this on purpose. And I don't know how you picture Jesus' face, but I don't picture Jesus' face going, hey, what's up, guys? You want to go out to dinner? Walking out in the lake? I think he had a smile. Hey, guys. They were like, whoa, they were freaked out. Why? Because this is not possible. This is not supposed to happen. And, of course, there's one knucklehead that sees this and sees this as an opportunity. And 27, Jesus immediately said to them, take courage. It is I. Don't be afraid. Tell someone, don't be afraid. Whatever in your life seems fatal or as is and cannot be changed, the gospel message is do not be afraid. It says, Lord, if it's you, Peter replied, and of course this knucklehead, sees Jesus walk on the water and sees an opportunity. Tell me to come unto you on the water. 29, Jesus says, come, he said. I bet you he was smiling. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid and began to sink, cried out, Lord, save me. Now, you can look at this text two ways. You can look at it half full or half empty. Some of you guys are cynics. You're like, Peter, sinking in the water. What an idiot. You know, come on. If you're going to do it, you need to do it right. Half empty. What a disaster. Now, if you're a half full thinker, you're like, wow, the dude walked on water. That's like walking on the moon for the first time. I mean, this is the first human in history to defy physics. He walked in the water. And I'm like, that's really amazing. Some of us will look at it like that. Others will look at it the other way. Because some of us value percentages over growth. Because, I'm afraid because many of us have Asian backgrounds. We're taught to value percentages. Right? I mean, my parents taught me about percentages since I was growing up. Value system. I wouldn't be able to get a video game in junior high if I didn't get 10 hundreds in a row. My dad said, oh, no, you got 9 hundreds in a row, and the next one was a 99. You can't get Super Mario. One or two or three, you can't get that. I'm like, Dad, but isn't 9 pretty good? I think the teacher cheated me, by the way. It was an essay question. He's like, I don't care, it's no ifs or buts. If you don't get 100, this is our deal. This is our contract. This is binding contract. You don't get a game. I'm like, Dad, come on. I was taught since, through my tiger parents, that perfection is the only way you do it. You don't get anything wrong. It's about right and wrong. And you need to get everything right about your life, not wrong. If you get more right in your life, you'll progress more. In essence, they really didn't care about growth with grades. All they cared about was percentages. Ernest Hemingway said that the first draft of anything is chisel. Well, that's a collaboration between Snoop Doggy Dogg and Ernest Hemingway. You never heard that before, right? That's a pretty cool collaboration because I can't say that word, so I decided to use that. But Ernest is right, a prolific author, American author. I mean, he's telling us that there's nothing in life we can do perfectly in the beginning. No work of mastery has ever been accomplished the first time. The author of Jurassic Park, which is one of my favorite movies, I never read the book, because I don't need to. The movie's amazing. Especially the new one with Chris Pratt. I mean, He said that books are not written, they're rewritten. Now, how does this apply to our lives? I know that most of us live in the real world with real deadlines and real performance evaluations where everything is counted. We count baseball stats, we count basketball stats, talking about Russell Westbrook having the greatest season ever. I disagree with that. Michael Jordan had a greater season one season, but where he won MVP and Defensive Player of the Year. Russell Westbrook, he's never playing defense. Okay, anyway. But we count everything. Everything matters, our net worth, our grades, our weight, our sizes. Everything is about percentages with this. We're obsessed with percentages. And therefore, it's really easy to feel like a failure and afraid to try anything because everything is counted. Your credit score is counted. Make a payment late. Oh, you're not responsible. You see that? Now I'm going to raise your interest rate for your mortgage in the future. So you miss one payment, you're 21. You had no money at 29. I got you. That's the world. They penalize you for percentages. But if you look at this text, what is highlighted? Jesus doesn't highlight failure. Matthew tells the story, and Matthew tells the story because he is recording Peter's preaching. Jesus highlights growth. What's never happened before. How Peter actually disrupted something that's never done before. And he actually grew in faith. Because none of those other 11 doubters got out of the boat. They're not exempt. Jesus values and highlights growth over percentages. And that's why when it comes to faith, you don't have to get everything right. You don't have to do everything perfectly. It's about moving towards Jesus and more towards God. That what's highlighted in this text is Peter's courage. You know, there's one grade that my son got. He's 10. In writing. And because I'm a writer, we take that seriously at our house. He was being lazy with his assignments, and he was just getting a satisfactory. If I got a satisfactory when I was 10 in my house, I would have been locked up in a dungeon. That's why grace moves from generation to generation in Christian families. You see that? So I'm hoping that when he's a father, that like we're not okay with D's. You know what I'm saying? But there's only one grade that we use a magnet and put in our refrigerator at our house. And it's not 100. It's just a B+. Right? They don't want to, you know, psychologists think kids are frail now, so they give them from 1 to 4. They don't do these grades per se. But he improved his writing because my wife literally locked him in a room and just went over every single answer, assertion, evidence, and then he started working harder. And at the final report card, he went from a 3 to a 4. But we don't highlight that report card because that's a perfect score now. No, we highlight from 2 to 3 in our refrigerator. What's highlighted in our house, we're trying to move away from that tribal cultural value of performance and percentages, and try to highlight, to teach our kids, the gospel value. We care about your improvement. We care about you, your development. We don't care about percentages, because percentages do not determine your value. We care about how you grow. And that's the beauty of the gospel, folks. That's why you don't need to be fatalistic about your faith or anything in your life. God's not being like, oh, I can't believe you're again. You're depressed again. Take a pill, bro. Oh, you're struggling with the sin again? Come on. How many times I got to tell you, don't do it? I mean, if you look at a fatalistic worldview and the worldly values, the cultural values are shaping your identity, then of course people don't want to come to church. People don't want faith. Because they think that God values what's suffocating them. What's highlighted in my refrigerator and what's highlighted in this text is what? First lesson we learn. Jesus what? Read it with me. Jesus highlights growth over percentages. It's about developing. the participle. ing. You can take that to the bank. Never say, I'm humble. I've learned that past tense. I've learned. I used to say that when I'm 21. I've learned humility. I told one professor, I've learned humility when I was 16. He's like, what? I've learned that already. No. There's you see, in the universe, and you want to talk about that's a macro picture. The universe is not fixed, and it's not done. It's still evolving. We don't know where it's going, exactly how that's working. So then when you bring it to a micro level in your own personal life, there's nothing that we're done in. So even your struggles, you're not done in. And even the things you're really good at, you're not done in. You're learning. You're developing. Right? I mean, Harvard Business Books make this a new trend recently that the greatest cause of burnout in corporate America, the greatest burnout in America is not overworking. A lot of people said that millennials are lazy. And I see that a little bit. But the truth is they did surveys of millions of people with psychologists, and they collaborated together. And what they found out is that people are burned out by overworking. They're burned out by lack of development. They're stuck in the same place. And they're doing something mindless over and over again. There's no creativity. There's no challenge. They're just doing the same things. And they don't want more money or more bonuses. They just want an investment to be the best of who they are. They want to feel proud of their work. They want to, when they leave the office, wherever, how late, they want to feel like they contributed to something that made a difference. You see, even corporate America is moving toward reality of who Jesus is. I mean, if you're not a Christian, this is exactly why you need to pay attention to this. That Jesus values growth over percentages. That there's a safe place to fail and learn and grow. And you're not going to be punished for that. Amen? So what do you value in your life? Do you value percentages or growth? Because that will really determine how much you can grow personally. And if you want to do something revolutionary, whether in nonprofit, whether in business, if you have a fixed mindset and fatalistic mindset about how things are in the world, then you're just a seat in a cubicle that can't do anything about it. You're going to be enslaved to that system. But if you allow the gospel to save you, who knows who you can be? Who knows what you can accomplish? And who knows who you can become? And that's what Jesus is interested in. So people, if you want to walk on water, what do you got to do? Like Jay-Z said, you got to get on the boat. All right, let's move down. So immediately, Jesus reached out his hand. And what did he do? He called Peter. You see that? Jesus was playing. First, he did Casper. Second, Peter, the knucklehead, goes, oh, Jesus, if you're walking, tell me to come on you, come to you. And then Peter goes, and now he's walking on water. He took a couple of steps, 2-3 steps, 5 steps, you know. And those of you who judge Peter, you should be ashamed of yourself. I hope your parents didn't go be like, when you were crawling for this or walking the first time, they'd be like, oh, you can't even walk in a straight line. What is wrong with you? You don't know how to run? What's wrong with you? I mean, no parent says that when you walk for the first time. This kid is, we have to take him to a psychiatrist. There's something wrong with this kid. He can't walk in a straight line. He's been drinking. I mean, you think about that. And I remember here when I read this passage, it's so powerful. Jesus doesn't say you don't have any faith. Jesus doesn't say, why'd you do that. He says he caught him before falling in the water, because that would have been traumatizing, or maybe death. You have to do it, raise him from the dead, maybe. But he reached out his hand and caught him, and he said, you of what? That means you have some faith. Can you imagine? All you need is a little faith to walk on water. That's the other side of fatalism. That's not optimism. That's realism. With God, all things are what, the Bible says? Possible. And it's not gigantic faith to walk on water. It's, Jesus says, what? Little faith. I mean, you can look at that in a bad way, a negative way, or you could look at that as an opportunity, invitation to do some crazy things in life. And like Jesus said, all you need is a faith of what? A little mustard seed. He says, and he goes, little faith, why did you doubt? I remember when I was teaching a course and preaching, one student was really passionate about this passage. And in the end, he said, he acted like Jesus. He did a first-person narrative of the sermon. And he said, Peter, why did you doubt? You were the chosen one. He did like Anakin Skywalker. You were the chosen one. Why'd you doubt? I was listening to the message. I'm like, what? Peter, you hurt me. You failed me. I was just like, I stopped the message. I said, bro. I didn't say that. I used academic language. I said, that's not who the Father is. And he sat there, and I said, do you want me to tell you why'd you betray me, how you failed this message? But I said, it's not about percentages, bro. It's when you speak the gospel, I hope that it's not about a grade or looking good, but it's about representing who God is. And God is not that, what you're betraying. That depiction of Jesus is completely wrong. You need to work on your theology. Sit down and repent, bro. Because, I mean, if my son is the first person to go to Mars, which I'm hoping for and praying, I'm not going to be like, why didn't he go there faster? Peter walked on water. It's not like he did something that someone else did 1,000 times. Because when you come second to something, people are like, oh, whatever. Do you remember the first person to go around Earth's orbit 3 times? No, you don't remember them. Oh, who you remember? The first person who went to the moon. Neil Armstrong. And everybody else who went before him, no one remembers. But the person who goes first always is great on a curve. You got to give them grace. You got to give them mercy. Just like the baby when they're taking, I'm realizing that all parents are worried that their kids, there's something wrong with them. Because I remember 4 months, I'm like, Nathan's never going to walk. I was like, honey, I asked her every week, do you think we should take him to the doctor? He's my son. He should be fast. My wife's like, you need to relax. And then at nine months, my wife was like, do you think we should take him to the doctor? I was like, you need to relax. But if you look at this text, Jesus was not judging Peter. He was proud of him. He caught him with a smile. I believe that Jesus had a smile the whole time. First time he went out there, hey guys, spooked him, did Casper on him. Second time when he called Peter to come to him on the water. Jesus knew that he wouldn't do it perfectly, but he did it. He was courageous. Then those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, truly, you are the Son of God. Maybe what needs to happen in our lives, for some Christians, what if Jesus transformed certain parts of your character that you think is impossible to change, and other people saw it? Because when I see that, when I saw my dad go from like almost an alcoholic, my brother says, to a Christian that stopped drinking, stopped smoking, start going to church at 6 a.m., my brother was like, there's a God. Because dude, he used to come at home, pound the door, throw things, be a drunk. And then when he came to Christ, he stopped doing all that. And then at 6 a.m., instead of coming in home drunk, he went to get drunk in the spirit. And my brother said, that is enough evidence for me that there is a God. And I was like, true. I was like, true, that's logical. Because fatalism to a Christian is the death nail for God to do anything miraculous. And that's where you're bored all the time. You're always on the boat looking at everybody else. Oh, that's not me. Just going to be in the boat. And so the challenge for the Christian then is to step out of the boat. Let Jesus save you from all the incentive of fatalism. There's nothing you lose with Jesus in the gospel because he doesn't grade. He grades on a curve. When you take the first steps to any new arena, anything you do in your life, he's not judging you. He's like, come on, let's go. You're going to fall, but you're going to learn. I don't know about you, but Peter in heaven right now is bragging about water walking. he's telling his other 12, his friends, you guys never walked on water. I did. Because he really is a water walker. And that's the only title he's going to have that for like eternity. And when you go to heaven, hopefully, I mean, you know, you'll hear him talk about it. But he did something no one else did, and Jesus was smiling about it. And so the second lesson we learn from this passage is what? It's very clear that Jesus values what? Direction over what? Perfection. For some of us, this is like new systems to think through. Right? We give up when we can't do something perfectly. You know, when I was young, I used to quit games because I didn't get a perfect score. I was disappointed when I didn't get a 4.0. I mean, some of you guys identify with that. Oh, I didn't get a 4.0. I suck. Right? I mean, perfection is grilled a lot of times into overachieving folks, especially that. And what that does is it prevents us from moving out and taking risks for God. And this is for also the seeker. I mean, what seeker knows how to pray? You know, people say, we talked about many seekers that came to Christ, and they go, hey, once you pray, they go, oh, no thanks. Why? I don't know what to say. I don't know how to do it. I mean, who knows how to talk? My kids, when they started talking, they sounded like idiots. But I wasn't like, yo, why are you an idiot? I was like, honey, he said daddy or dada or dawa. That's amazing. If you're a seeker today and you're like, well, I don't know how to do this. I don't know this. That's not who Jesus is. Jesus is about direction over perfection. You can come as you are, you can stutter, you can stumble, because it's all about the heart. It's all about moving toward God, seeking out to him. And he did this for people who were doubting. That's why he walked on water. That's why he did Casper, to show people that he is who he said he is. So Jesus values direction over perfection. All God's people say. Amen. That's good news. Stand with me. Will you pray with me? Lift your hands to the Lord today. And for the believer, perhaps you need to surrender some fatalistic beliefs to God. Say, no, this is never going to happen. This can't happen. This can't change. This is just the way it is going to be. But for the seeker, also, you know, I don't know. Am I ever going to know enough? Am I ever going to feel safe enough? Forget those thoughts. Move toward Jesus. Move toward God, and let him catch you when you fall. And that's when you're going to realize the power of the gospel is not about valuing right or wrong, but values relationship.
Carry me. You lead me to your courts. You lead me here to your courts. Surround me with your love. I walk with you. I do not fear. In this place, dreams are made. In this place, where you carry me.
As we sing the song and close in prayer, I want you to know right now that if we can allow, give God our fatalism, our fixed mindset, then the amount you can flourish in your life, not just in your faith, in your life, in your whole person, would be exponentially, the trajectory of your life would be exponentially different. The Bible says that God wants to take you from glory to glory, from faith to faith. You don't need percentages. You don't need 100% faith. Jesus said to Peter, "You have little faith," and he walked on water. Today, I want to pray, God, that you would give us a vision of a flourishing, a human flourishing in our lives through Christ that we could not have imagined apart from being imprisoned by our own fatalistic lens of our lives. Lord, unleash our imagination about what we can do in Christ, who we can become in Christ, for the greatest good. Help us, God, become people that will touch everyone we're in relationship with, because we're flourishing. We're growing inside out. And then use, God, those competencies, those gifts you've given us to disrupt industry for the greater good. Help us, God, get out of the boat so we can walk on water, so others can worship Jesus and see the power of God in our lives. Carry me.
Carry me. Carry me.
Bow your heads for the benediction. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of God's Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. All God's people say, amen. God bless you. Go in peace.